Will the high tribunal under its new chief justice allow this? You have to remember, Sereno had a very strong dissenting opinion the last time. Attorney Marco Sardilio, who was once with the PCGG but is an advocate and a lawyer. Are you still lawyering? For the farmers, will be joining us next on Hot Coffee. You're watching Head Start with me, Karen Davila. Any hope for the cocoa farmers when we return?
Pinatunayan ng germometer. Dapat dyan, new Surf Antibacterial Fabric Conditioner. Patay ang up to 99% ng germs.
New Surf Antibacterial Fabric Conditioner. 5 pesos lang, wais.
To have what it takes to be a top newsmaker, take on any challenge. Live a healthy lifestyle with a balanced diet, exercise, enough sleep, and a male multivitamin that keeps up with a man's endurance, potency, and vitality. Be at the top of your game with the ABS-CBN News Channel and Rogen E for the man on top.
Hot Copy, the cocoa levy case has long been a hotly contested issue. With the appointment of a new chief justice, coconut farmers are now calling for the reopening of the case, hoping they will still be able to recover the San Miguel shares of businessman Danding Cojuangco. All right, let's take a look back, because a lot of you have forgotten, so have I, all about this case.
On April 2011, the Supreme Court ruled in favor of awarding 20% of San Miguel shares to businessman Eduardo Danding Cojuangco. In January this year, the High Court awarded another block, about 24% of SMC shares, to the government. According to the Supreme Court, the April decision is final. With the appointment of Supreme Court Chief Justice Maria Lourdes Sereno and her vow to pursue judicial reforms, a coalition of coconut farmers is pushing for the reopening of the cocoa levy case against Cojuangco. They plan to file the motion before the Supreme Court in 2 weeks. In June 2011, then Associate Justice Sereno dissented from the majority, holding the opinion that the SMC shares belong to the government.
All right, I need to read that graphic again, Direka. Can you prepare that in a few minutes? All right, first, we have with us Attorney Marco Sardillo, former PCGG Executive Director, and now a volunteer lawyer for the Coalition of Farmers. I'd have to say thank you for coming back.
Thank
it looks
Karen.
Like your efforts
you.
Are going somewhere.
Thank you, Karen.
All right,
been
first,
praying.
Yeah, take us back to it. What shares specifically are you fighting for in San Miguel?
Right, perhaps I should clarify that there are two blocks of shares, two big blocks. You have 20%, and those are the Cojuangco block. That is a Cojuangco block. And then there's a 24%, which was awarded this year in January to the Republic to be used for the entire coconut industry. The decision...
How much is the 24%?
The 24%
right, of the shares?
It's anywhere from about 80 to about 100 something billion pesos.
Okay.
Although there are very interesting issues, side issues there, perhaps
okay.
at some other point, because those shares were converted sometime in 2009.
Okay.
That was also debated at some point.
So what are you fighting for, the 20%?
We're fighting for the 20%, which was awarded to Mr. Cojuangco last year, in April
okay.
of last year. The Supreme Court has said that that is already final and executory.
Uh-oh.
There was an entry of judgment that was received, I think, sometime in April this year.
Okay.
But with the appointment of the Chief Justice Sereno and her very strong dissent, in fact, she hinted that perhaps mm-hmm. through newly discovered evidence or
okay.
other justifiable reason, there might be another opportunity to revisit this ruling
Uh-oh.
And, in fact, honor history. In
All right.
Ways.
Okay, let's discuss first the 20% Danding Cojuangco shares.
Right.
in San Miguel, and take us slowly through it, because I
sure.
did a docu on this, but I can't remember
right.
it exactly right now. How much are we talking about estimate
right.
these shares are worth?
Right. The estimate is anywhere about 80 billion pesos, which I think about, in the separate opinion of Justice Brion, he estimated that to be about 5% of the 2010 national budget. Just imagine, that's
Good
a lot.
God. Okay, all right, so let's put it to, let's peg
sure.
it at 80 billion, that
sure.
20% shares in San Miguel. How many farmers groups are after the 20% shares?
Yeah. There's about 12 farmer groups, but then we're actually fighting for 3.5 million coconut farmers. And that, if you include their families, that's 20 million Filipinos.
Uh-oh.
So, you know, never before has the scales of justice put on the one hand 3.5 million coconut farmers, 20 million Filipinos, and on the other, one individual.
Okay.
Or as Kaoka calls him, one lucky individual.
Okay. But these 3.5 coconut farmers, you have proof that they, in effect, now were actually paying the levy during that time,
right.
during Marcos's time.
Right. The end goal really is to recover it at the end of the day for the entire coconut industry.
Yes, I agree.
So, and in fact, that's part of the reason why, in that other decision, that other block, because that is being claimed by this farmers group called CocoFed. They claim it on behalf of 1 million unnamed farmers. As far as we are concerned, this belongs to the entire coconut
yeah,
industry.
Yeah, but that's a bit unfair. Are you trying to tell me that the 24% is just going to like 1 million unnamed farmers?
No, and this is why we're happy with the ruling. In fact, this January, the Supreme Court ruled that it is owned by the government, the
yeah.
24%, and to be used only for the entire coconut industry and for the benefit of the coconut farmers.
Okay.
So, and we will have, and we hope for the same thing, for the 20%. If we are able to recover this, this should only be used for the entire coconut industry and no specific farmer groups. It's for everyone.
Okay.
As long as you're a legitimate coconut farmer, you
even
should
today.
Benefit. Oh, yes.
All right.
Yes.
Okay. Now, before we go to the Supreme Court decisions, you need to explain first why it's the Danding Cojuangco shares that you believe belong to the coconut farmers. What is the trail?
Right. The thing about it is that when that case was actually, well, those shares were awarded to Mr. Cojuangco, they were claiming that there was not enough proof, in fact. But what's interesting about it is that even Justice Carpio Morales and Justice Sereno, in her dissent, they all say that there is more than enough proof.
Yeah.
And
no, but
sure.
I mean, let's go back first. During that time, what was Danding's role?
He was a director on he was on top of PCA, and in
uh-huh.
fact,
so he was the one collecting supposedly
yes.
the levy.
Right. It was
okay.
a state-facilitated monopoly of the coconut industry.
Okay.
And the last time I was here, I mentioned to you that there are academic journals and articles precisely on crony capitalism that talks about this. Just last week, I sent an email to a Korean professor. He's teaching in the States. He wrote a book on crony capitalism in South Korea and the Philippines, and this is the case study.
This is the case study.
Yes.
All right. Okay. So what, okay, the case, what Attorney Marco, what you are saying, to in a nutshell, because we don't have
sure.
A lot of time, is essentially the levy that the farmers were paying
yes.
were not used properly to improve
right.
their status. And supposedly, allegedly,
right.
Danding Cojuangco then, as a businessman, had put it in San Miguel
right.
on his own, for
Correct.
His own purpose. Is that the allegation?
Well, the claim of Mr. Cojuangco is that it was just a private loan from a private bank.
Yeah.
And in which case, the obligation of a private borrower is really just to repay the loan. And here's what's interesting. Because that was a decision last year. With a decision this year, the Supreme Court is in effect telling us that the UCPB is not a private bank. It is a public corporation. And in which case, Mr. Cojuangco was at the time a public officer.
Okay.
So that changes the entire thing. And which is why I think that's one of those justifiable reasons that would really call to question or
okay.
pull the rug from under that decision.
All right. So moving now back.
Sure.
Moving forward now to 2011, okay,
yeah.
from a little bit of history.
Yes.
All right. Is in 2011, what was very
sure.
Surprising was how many justices, okay, this
sure.
one, you lost this particular
yes,
decision.
This is the Danding Cojuangco block. You have seven justices voting and deciding.
Who are these justices?
This is Justice Bersamin, then Chief Justice Corona, Justice Abad, Justice Del Castillo, Justice Velasco, Justice Perez, and Justice Villarama.
So you call this the Cojuangco block?
I didn't. No, it's the Cojuangco block of shares. I'm not referring to them.
Yes. The Cojuangco block of shares.
Yes,
okay, that's
just so we're clear. Yes.
Kasi baka nanonood din Supreme Court sa
Opo,
atin.
Ay, hindi po.
Hindi yun yun. But ang naging decision
yes.
in effect in 2011 is...
This is a screen grab of that decision. They said, although EO number 1 and the other issuances did not include an explicit definition of ill-gotten wealth. And then these same justices, this is April of 2011, same justices
in 2012
make reference to the definition of ill-gotten wealth.
Oh, under but did the they change their decision? No.
It's because this pertains to the other block of shares. This is the one,
this
is the farmer's block. And by the way,
that's so interesting.
And in not just that, in 2005, look at this.
Oh.
As early as 2005, involving, again, a case involving Mr. Cojuangco, the definition has always been there.
Okay.
All of a sudden, from 2005, come 2011, they completely forgot, they overlooked the fact that there is a definition of ill-gotten wealth.
So what you are saying, the same Supreme Court justices
yes.
said there is no
definition
of ill-gotten wealth when it came to Danding's 20%
yes.
shares. But when it came to the 24% government
Correct.
Shares, they were able to define ill-gotten wealth.
Correct.
Yeah, that is weird.
And I should clarify as well.
Okay.
Because in that same case, last year, I'll use this other one.
Oh, go ahead.
Because what the Supreme Court, in fact, did also was they invalidated the writs of sequestration that were issued by the PCGG. This was Section 3 of the same rules of the PCGG.
Okay.
But
explain the writ of sequestration.
No, there was a time when, you know, right after the EDSA Revolution, the Commission would issue a writ of sequestration in order to sequester certain assets.
Uh-uh.
What's interesting is that in that decision, they say that, oh, there's no definition, Section 3. But Section 1 of the same rules is the definition of ill-gotten wealth.
Really?
It is there.
Yeah.
That's
no, and
Section 1.
I remember when Ombudsman Conchita Carpio Morales, I remember this, was still a Supreme Court justice. She had said something like, this is ridiculous or
she
something.
She said that this is the biggest joke to
yes.
hit the century. Yes.
Yeah, that's the classic Carpio Morales line on
right.
this particular.
Why? Because when the Supreme Court overlooked that there is a real definition of ill-gotten wealth, they made up a definition of their own. And because of that
so
definition...
what is their definition?
Their definition is, now we have to even prove cronyship, the fact of cronyship. And that is not true. Because it's not there in the rules. It's not in the definition of ill-gotten wealth. And that's what's funny about it. And as I predicted months ago when I was still in my past incarnation, I said that if we let this decision stand, you can expect almost all of those other ill-gotten wealth cases to start getting dismissed.
Yeah.
And interestingly enough, it happened. That case against Mr. Lushutan has been dismissed. Why? Because the Supreme Court said, the Sandigan Bayan said, this is the definition and not the real definition.
You're a very brave kid. You better watch yourself.
No.
Okay. All right. No. What is Chief Justice Sereno's dissenting opinion when she was a Supreme
right.
Court Justice? Okay. Derek, can you put it back on screen? This is her, this is not the dissenting opinion, this is her statement today.
No, that is the dissenting opinion.
Okay, can you read it? You read it out loud. Okay, all right, go.
When the
this
time,
is the, what year was this?
This was last year of 2011.
Okay, the dissenting opinion of Sereno.
When the time comes that the legal impediment presented before the court today is lifted, perhaps through newly discovered evidence or another justifiable reason, the opportunity to revisit the ruling of this court may present itself, and Philippine history may have a chance to be redeemed in part.
Okay, next page, go.
And so, I vote to grant the motions for reconsideration and find the Cojuangco block of SMC shares to have been acquired with public funds and thus public assets that are forfeited in favor of the government.
That's your strongest statement so far. Kinilabutan ako reading that.
And if I may add, honestly,
you saw a ray of hope there.
Really, I was praying and I was so happy when I found out. What's interesting is that...
Mayro sa'yo ka pang andala eh.
Salamat po.
Nagulat nga ako, ito direct. No, mayro sa'yo talaga si Mark Andala.
No, we all pray for this cause.
Dito sa Seth. Oo. Oh, come on.
No, what's interesting is that, you know, her dissenting opinion almost never made it to the resolution of the Supreme Court.
It really?
It was reissued with the attached dissenting opinion. We received the initial resolution June. We got this July.
Okay.
So...
You mean to say the first one you got had no dissenting opinion of Justice Sereno?
Exactly. It was not attached at the time.
But can they do that?
Interesting times call for I don't know what.
Okay, and then you got a new en banc notice with a reattachment.
Right. It's the same resolution except it has this note. With due respect to our beloved Supreme Court, and I hope that the Filipino people understand that you don't just worry about justice delayed, justice denied. It's also when you rush to judgment that there might be injustice.
Okay.
When the Supreme Court decided to expunge, and there's a difference between expunging and denying an MR, they expunged the Republic's pleadings last August 16.
Okay.
I must point out, remember that in this case, the vote is very tight. It's 7-4-4. Of all the days when they could take a vote, August 16 was a time when there were two justices who were on leave, and there were two vacancies in the court. And August 16 was a day when Justice Bienvenido was appointed, so before he could even assume office, the Supreme Court decided to take a vote. And exactly 1 month later, September 16, Justice Estela Bernabe Reyes was also appointed to the Supreme Court. Again, never mind that it's so hard to get your vote because it's a 7-4-4. It's so tight.
Yeah.
And I should point out, for example,
that what year?
This was last year. This was August 16.
Already Pinoy.
Yes. Because we were trying to fight for this case. We were trying to introduce a diary to talk about, to point out the errors in this decision.
Yeah.
But what happened was the Supreme Court said, well, you know what? As early as June, we already told you that we will not be entertaining any more pleadings.
Okay.
Because a second motion for reconsideration is a prohibited pleading.
All right.
That's
now,
what they said.
The question now is that there's been talk that Mr. Danding Cojuangco has already sold his shares, frankly.
Sure.
I mean, I've heard it that it's been sold to 5 businessmen already.
Sure.
Let's not mention the names because I'm not sure right now.
Sure.
So that it's been sold to 5 businessmen. So the parang ang tanong dito, simple lang to ha, parang binigay na ngayon 24% sa gobyerno eh.
Right.
Hinihingi nyo pa yung 20%, yun ang iisipin nila. Di, posibleng ang isipin ng ilan is di gamitin ng gobyerno yung 24% for all the farmers.
Correct.
That's 80 billion.
Correct.
Why ruin already? I mean, San Miguel Corporation, to be fair, is a good company. It's a big company and it employs a lot of Filipinos. So those 20% may not even be there. Yan ang tanong ko sa'yo.
Correct. At the end of the day,
Ramon Ang already running San Miguel.
At the end of the day, we're talking about the moral victory and the moral issues that are involved in this case. We are writing history at this point. I mean, just imagine, I was 4 years old, my sister and I were tearing down posters of the late dictator in front of the town plaza. And now, people do not get agitated enough. They don't even know about the cocoa levies. I was venting to a friend of mine because they don't even understand this issue anymore. No one cares. In fact, with this decision, the Supreme Court has effectively, to respect, rewritten history because Mr. Cojuangco apparently is not even a crony or a close associate of Mr. Marcos based on that decision of April 2011. And like I said, it's very rare when the Supreme Court actually not just writes a decision, it also writes history. At this point, they are making of record exactly the involvement of Mr. Cojuangco during those times. And just imagine you're...
So this is the record you're saying that they will see.
Yes.
So is this about the money?
Obviously not. Oh, dear Lord God.
At the end of the day, it's more about the money.
It's not. You know, because the people who contributed to these levies, a lot of them are dying, if not dead. So, unfortunately, they don't have the money for stem cell or for any of those transplants. These people are dying. And these people paid for these levies, and they were collected upon the brow of their sweat. Let's remember, 3.5 million coconut farmers and 20 million Filipinos. So it is a moral crusade. It cannot be just about the money. The government can give us all the money that we need, but it's going to be a different thing, right? And this is ill-gotten wealth. Assuming that it's been transferred to all these buyers, I don't subscribe to the belief that there's such a thing as an innocent purchaser for value. You know that these shares, or at least, you know, of such notoriety, that caveat emptor. In fact, as far as I'm concerned, here's a very simple metaphor of when you talk about ill-gotten wealth. If I'm a crony of the late dictator, and I put poison in your cup, in whosever hands that cup will be, that will still be poison.
Yeah.
It will still be ill-gotten wealth.
That's true.
And which is why the Constitution, in fact, tells us that the actions to recover ill-gotten wealth will never prescribe. In fact, I can die tomorrow, and, well, I don't have children, but if I had children, my children can continue this crusade. Because actions to recover ill-gotten wealth will not prescribe.
Oh, really?
It will not prescribe. The Constitution tells us that. Plus, I'm sorry to say this, but this decision, and that's the argument we're making to the Supreme Court, it's a void decision. In which case, it will never become final, and it can never become a source of rights.
Why is it a void decision?
Because the Constitution is very clear. Article 8, Section 14 requires that decisions of any court, and that includes the Supreme Court, it should indicate the law and the facts on which they are based.
Wala ba dyan?
Kasi po yung law na ginamit nila, this is not the pertinent law. That is not the real legal definition of ill-gotten wealth. Correct?
Mm.
Because they denied, effectively they denied that it even exists. And like I've been telling people, questions of law, sure, it is the Supreme Court that has the sole jurisdiction over that. You and I can argue about the interpretation of laws. But when the Supreme Court tells us this is how it's supposed to be, we keep quiet. But questions of existence, oh dear God, that's everyone's obligation. Because the law requires that, you know, ignorance of the law excuses no one. So when you tell me, for example, that, oh, there is no law, there is no definition of ill-gotten wealth, and I'm able to show you, oh, guess what, there is. Isn't that a question of existence? We all know and everyone can see it, and it's sad if you're going to let a decision stand that denies that existence.
Okay. All right. We'll take a quick break. When we return, we'll continue our conversation with Attorney Marco Sardillo. This is about the Coco Levy case. Will it be reopened by the Supreme Court? Hot copy. We'll be right back.
Kahit saan may germ. Huh? Kahit dito, na pinatunayan ng germometer. Dapat dyan, new Surf Antibacterial Fabric Conditioner. Patay ang up to 99% ng germs.
New Surf Antibacterial Fabric Conditioner. 5 pesos lang, wais.
First, I'm very impressed what I saw here today. So it's really... Coming from Europe, you see the elements of beauty which we see in Switzerland, in Denmark, and other areas. So, I mean, we would really embrace the same kind of environment.
I think your team, about the 2 years rehabilitation in this area, it's better than last time, like that. But our problem is water quality. Any developing, any project, first is that we make planning. Before planning, we study this condition. We cannot rush, step to step.
We all had the same problem. It took in Germany 30 years to get the rivers clean. The Philippines should look at it that we have to go through the same process and have to be patient to some extent, like all the other countries which had to go through that. I think it's the right approach to get all the various stakeholders put in place. I think that's the only way to go because nobody can carry that load on his own shoulders. So everybody has to work together.
With your help, the river will flow with life again.
All right, welcome back to Hot Copy. With us is Attorney Marco Sardilio, a volunteer lawyer for the Coalition of Farmers who are seeking the reopening of the cocoa levy case. Okay, our Twitter followers right here. Okay, the cocoa levy is a big social justice issue. Kudos to Attorney Sardilio for fighting for the farmers. That's Yogon. Thank you, Yogon, for watching.
Thank you.
But this is suki natin to, ha? Si Mang Pandoy. Okay, I'll ask all his questions. Haven't the shares been sold to Ramon Ang et al? How do you plan to recover them? Innocent purchaser of value yon. Tas tanong, by asking the SC to reopen the case, aren't you asking the Supreme Court to flip-flop? Oh, that's a good question too. Isn't this dangerous? Everything that was decided by the Corona Court will be revisited now.
Right.
Your take.
All right.
First of all, how do you plan to recover? Mang Pandoy's good questions. Well, when innocent purchaser of value.
Correct. Like I said, as far as I'm concerned, ill-gotten wealth remains ill-gotten regardless of conversion or in whosoever hands it may be.
Okay, by asking the Supreme Court to reopen the case, aren't you asking the SC to flip-flop?
No. With due respect, the majesty of the law is that while we aspire for the transcendent, we want justice, the law recognizes that human beings are, you know, imperfect, in which case it is actually one of the recognized exceptions. While a judgment may become final, there are exceptions to that. If a judgment is void, it will never become final. If there are supervening circumstances, for example, that would make the execution of that final decision unjust and inequitable, you know the person who wrote that? The person who wrote that was the same ponente, in fact, who wrote the decision in favor of Mr. Cojuangco.
All right. Isn't this dangerous? Everything that was decided by the Corona Court will be revisited.
No, it is not dangerous because what we're talking about is a question of fairness. And fairness is as simple as, are we in the same situation? Are you talking about 3.5 million coconut farmers? Are you talking about social justice? Are you talking about issues where you have the Supreme Court deciding a case where they deny the existence of a law that clearly exists?
Okay.
Unless they're in that same situation, I don't think all the cases would be thrown open.
Article 8 Jester is also watching. He asks, the Supreme Court disregarded the definition of ill-gotten wealth to reach a desired outcome. Your thoughts?
Correct. Well, I wouldn't say that they disregarded it. They could have overlooked it. What I do know is that in that decision of April 2011, they used Section 3 of the PCGG rules and regulations against the Republic. And then they said that there is no definition of ill-gotten wealth, when in Section 1 there is a definition of ill-gotten wealth. And then they proceeded to create this definition that set a very high level of proof required. And requiring, among others, even proof of the cronyship of Marcos and Cojuangco.
No, I mean, without hitting on any particular businessman or company, I want to ask you something. Do you really believe there's justice for the poor workers in this country? No, I'm asking you because I've done so many stories where you have, it's the less in life, those who have less in life, that really get the raw end of the deal.
Absolutely.
That's why I feel your cause, but it's the same. You have the Globe Asiatic homeowners, I mean, who have no titles to their property. You have these farmers who pay the levy, the taxes, and yet they did not get anything. It's the same.
I have to believe that there's still hope. I'll be honest with you. One of the first few times that I really became so involved in this cause was when I attended a national forum on cocoa levy.
Yeah.
And when I entered the auditorium, it was here in Quezon Circle, I nearly wept because I could feel the heaviness in the air.
Really?
See, my voice is starting to break.
Yeah.
Because you could feel that, you know, these people have lost hope. And we need to keep hoping for them if they can't do it for themselves. We need to keep believing that at the very least, you know, there's still something that can be done. A poor farmer approached me, in fact, and he said, Attorney Mayor, kahantungan ba itong ginagawa natin? I really have to believe.
Kasi nakapagod yung mga rally, mga
ano. And I told them, opo, opo talaga. And hanggat hindi ho kayo bibitaw, magkakasama ho tayo dito. You know, at the end of the day, we have to believe in justice. We have to believe that there is, you know.
Because you're one of Mary's stories. Huh? You have the FASAP case. I mean, that's the Flight Stewards Association. And I mean, I often wonder myself if, you know, in this country, the Supreme Court really thinks about, you know,
Well, at the end of the day, I think it's not just about the Supreme Court as well. It's also about my brothers and sisters in the profession. You know, we're supposed to be serving not just our clients, we're supposed to be serving the ends of justice.
Yeah.
I think it's also the obligation of the Filipino people. We talk about transparency and accountability. Just imagine, this decision has been there since April 2011, and no one has raised a howl, considering that, oh, you know what? I've seen that definition. It exists.
Yeah, none.
Right? No one has raised a howl. And in fact, and I appreciate that, you know, that's why we have the fourth estate, media people like you, the veteran journalist who did this story, Mr. Del Mundo. You know, at the end of the day, we need people like those, people, real advocates, who really just fight for justice, regardless of personalities and without worrying.
Because justice hurts. I mean, justice hurts, and sometimes when a personality is known, it becomes a person, they feel it's a personal attack, but it is not.
It's not. It's not. Absolutely not. At the end of the day, well, I'm a fairly devout Catholic, and we condemn the sinner and not the sin. You know, we try to do good at the end of the day. So there, it's nothing personal. And honestly, and this is true, I am praying for Mr. Cojuangco.
Okay.
Because it was not just the Republic or the coconut farmers who were deprived of an opportunity to be heard.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to know myself. I'd like to give him an opportunity, if this case is reopened, for him to rebut those allegations that he's a crony or a close associate of Mr. Marcos.
Uh-oh.
Otherwise, he will pass on, and that will forever be a cloud hanging over his memory.
Okay. All right. Aldrich Smile 319, this is on Twitter. Is Attorney Sardillo doing this as pro bono for the farmers?
I am. I was a pro bono farmer. I will become a farmer at some
now
point.
You've been pro bono?
I was pro bono before I left for my master's. That was when I graduated from law school.
Paano ka nabubuhay?
Now I work for an international organization.
Which
and
is?
I'm a consultant for ADB.
Okay,
but,
good.
In fact, it was one of my considerations. I only had two questions for them when they made the offer. Would I still be able to continue this crusade? And would I still be able to teach?
Uh-huh.
If they said no to any of those questions, I would have declined the offer.
Okay. All right. Now, I can't read the name, but Smart underscore 96, you know who you are. Do you think Justice Sereno can sway the seven lawyers to change their vote? I think he means seven justices. Go ahead.
I really have to believe that, you know, at the end of the day, the fact that they are called justice, they are the embodiment of justice. I would like to believe that every time they're called that, they will take it to heart. It's not really just a matter of Chief Justice Sereno swaying them. I would like to think that with this type of, you know, and everyone knows, we've all demonstrated now that there is a definition. The question is, are they going to stand by their error? Or are they going to stand with the 3.5 million coconut farmers, the 20 million Filipinos? We all see, I mean, you've seen it. The decision states there's no definition, when clearly there is a definition. So is it too late? Is it one of those things that we'll just accept? Well, sorry na lang, that's life. No, because you and I can say that, because we have our lives. But for these people, this will, you know, spell the difference between life and death for generations to come.
Mm-mm.
So there. I have to believe that perhaps, and I do appeal to them, that, you know, maybe they will see the
light. Is there a date for the reopening so far? What have you done?
We were supposed to file, in fact, today. But at the same time, we understand that there are people who would like to join us. I've created a website for this.
Uh-uh.
It's cocolevy.info. I'll be posting a lot of these information. I'm posting the manifestation for all the people to read. And we're issuing that open invitation to all the Filipinos out there.
Mm-mm.
If you care about social justice, if you care about justice with a capital J, if you care about these farmers, read the manifestation. See if you can support that message. If you see the errors too, then please, let's all get behind the message and we'll file it. We're looking to file it, fingers crossed, on September 10.
Okay, all right. Attorney Marcos Sardillo, I have to say, I admire you a lot. Okay, wait, aren't we going to air first a report? Okay, I want to air, I thought we were going to air the Habitat report before we go. Okay, all right, okay. I want you to see this. This is something we did just recently. Habitat for Humanity recently launched a coffee table book dubbed I Build My Philippines.